the work session for the Dolphin City Council when the oath commits. Dr. Fowler, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mayor, Vice Mayor, council members. Good evening, afternoonish, evening. So tonight we've got our first budget work session. After speaking with many of you after the proposed budget and then after the budget hearing, we thought the two topics that were most relevant for this evening would be on the compensation actions that were part of the proposed budget. And then the second topic for this evening, Mr. Patrick is here to talk us through. The mayor at the State of the City announced really what amounts to a historic investment in the Norfolk Public School System. It's somewhat unfortunate that that kind of got lost. I didn't see the media do much reporting on that, but that is an over $700 million investment in the school system over the next 30 years. What we'd like to do this evening, since the mayor has made the announcement, is sort of show you the behind the scenes on how Greg and I have gotten there with that number, and show you how we're going to be able to achieve that, as well as we're going to need to have a conversation about what the voting for that looks like. Obviously, this is over a 30-year period, so we have some options here in terms of, you know, do we do this in 10-year intervals? Do we want to do a full 30 years? We have to talk through that. I think Mr. Pishka will probably have some advice and thoughts on how it's best for council to memorialize this. It is definitely, this is an opportunity that we do not want to miss. We have this window of opportunity. We know this new revenue is coming through the casino, and it's our opportunity to make this commitment ongoing for the next three decades. So we're going to talk through that, and then we have George Homewood here this evening to provide a planning update on the Planning Commission and some of the items that you all see coming up on your docket. Before I start with the budget work session, sir, I did get some emails from council this afternoon, and I want to say this again. I think I'm on the record publicly saying this previously, but I want to say it again, and I'll probably have to say it upstairs as well when we get to the items on the docket. There still is a massive amount of confusion on ARPA. I've been trying my best. I think Greg has tried his best. I know Councilwoman Royster and others, you all have been doing your best to try and explain to folks out in the community, you know, what ARPA really entails. ARPA has a bunch of different types of money in the overall act. I wrote you all a memo on December 18th trying to lay out all of the various tranches of money. Some is going to be ours directly from the federal government. That is the $154 million state and local fiscal recovery fund money that we talked about at the retreat. Others, however, are not our money, but it is our money. It is money that has been passed to Commonwealth agencies for specific uses. So a few examples of that. One is the ARPA, the overall act, contained a large tranche of funding to enhance child care tax credit. We do not see that money directly as a city. However, our residents see it direct. So in an indirect manner, I mean, Norfolk is benefiting from that section of the American Rescue Plan Act. Another one, though, that is a little bit more direct tied to us is money for utility disconnections, eviction mitigation, behavioral health issues. Those are funds that are passed from the federal program, federal budget, directly to an appropriate Commonwealth agency, and then our departments apply to those Commonwealth agencies for grants. Three of those you're going to see this evening, R5, R6, and R8. So it's important to recognize that council has already appropriated ARPA funds, but they are not the $154 million for the state and local fiscal recovery funds. So these are funds that we only can apply for through a grant process with the appropriate government agency. The one caveat on your docket tonight is R8. R8 was a council request, I believe by Councilwoman Johnson and Councilwoman Royster. We had exhausted our CARES Act funding for eviction mitigation, and we still had a wait list. The councilwomen had asked if we could find a way to extend an eviction mitigation program with other funds. And tonight, I am asking, this is the first vote you all are effectively taking on the $154 million. I am recommending that we use $800,000 of the $154 million to extend that eviction mitigation program. That was a, housing was definitely one of the priorities that we heard on the survey for use of our specific ARPA funds, the state and local fiscal recovery funds. I believe it's an appropriate use of those funds. It also provides some budgetary savings to us because we have that money appropriated. We just need to find a source. So R8 is the first one. Other than that, all of the other actions associated with the $154 million are these neighborhood capital projects, the flood mitigation, the flood wall project, and the continuity of services funds. All of those will be in the May 10th budget for adoption. The reason I'm asking for your vote on R8 tonight with the $800,000 is we would like to hold the workshop for eviction mitigation before we vote on that May 10th. And I believe, Trista, when is that scheduled? Do we know?
We haven't, good evening, everyone. We haven't actually scheduled the date.
But we want to hold it.
Yes, we want to hold it before.
Before the vote on the budget.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, I think before we get going, I want to offer a resolution to allow Councilwoman Mamie Johnson to participate through electronic communication means for this work session. Mr. Bull.
Adopt the resolution, Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mr. Riddick.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigman.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye.
Riley, we continue.
Okay. Good.
Thank you, Mr. Mann, Dr. Fowler. I know you have a heavy agenda while we're down here, but I don't know when you plan to address it or how you plan to address it. But I think we really need to talk about firing of Chief Boone. And, you know, it's a lot going on in the community, and there's a lot going on, you know, for our city. Norfolk is, along with other cities nationwide, we're experiencing a white backlash. We have had black city managers for 13 years. That's Marcus and Regina Williams. And during that period of time, a lot of white staff members were, I guess they consider they were forgotten. So we're having issues as far as that's concerned. And we're having issues as far as the police chief is concerned. And I think the community, you know, needs to hear that. I don't know whether you go in closed session and realize what you're going to talk about. But, you know, it's something that we can't just you know, walk away from. And the other thing I mentioned to you and to the mayor, when we were planning the cruise terminal, I had suggested that we make enough room there for people who were boarding cruises could, you know, get slot machines. Well, now we have headwaters here. I'm wondering if we can move the preliminary headwaters place to the cruise terminal, Nautica, to prevent doing any construction over there as far as the hits at the park, and would also prevent having to locate the boxing center. And I was thinking with the two ships that we had yesterday, if we had had some headwaters over there, some type of table games or slots, it would have been a pretty good hit for us. So somehow I'd like to, when you get a chance, to talk about those things.
Yeah, I will. I think your thought on Nauticus is an excellent thought. I mean, we had thought about that. I'll let Mr. Pishko explain the legal constraints we have on both gaming, the full casino, and then the temporary.
Yes, I think just the temporary is all that you're asking about that, mm-hmm. in lieu of the hits at the park site.
Right.
We would have to get permission from both the General Assembly and the developer to change that. And the developer might well be agreeable to it, but the General Assembly is finishing up, and I do not see any prospect of getting them to make a decision in order for us to take advantage of the year or so that it would be open temporarily before the permanent. We don't have much time, and I think if we waited until the next General Assembly, we would be almost out of time. It would be over a year from now before that became law, unless it was made.
Any way at all of getting that to the General Assembly to see if we can get a...
We could always ask, but I don't think they would take it up until January, mm-hmm. and unless it was given a heightened priority, it wouldn't become law until July of 2022. And I think that the developer is hoping to have the permanent one open... 2020.
Yeah, it would probably be about a year and a half before the permanent one. So I think, Councilman Riddick, the constraint we have is the language for the temporary facility requires that it be in and around the footprint of the permanent facility.
Okay.
And so we can only go but so far away from where the permanent one is. As Mr. Pishko is alluding to, we could certainly approach the General Assembly and ask for some leniency and so on. But we had the very same thought about potentially doing a temporary facility over there, because I think you're right, it would be very beneficial. But I'm afraid at this point we don't have that, but certainly I'm happy to talk with council members if we'd like to broach that as a legislative item for the General Assembly.
Okay.
Have you guys looked at Military Circle as a temporary boxing location? There is currently a boxing center in there that is privately run. I've been speaking with a few people that are interested in doing a public-private partnership and operating our boxing center out of Military Circle. We don't have plans of demoing Military Circle anytime soon, at least that I'm aware of in the time frame that, by the time we can find a permanent location. But have we looked at that facility as an option? It's inside. It's got lots of space.
Yeah, I'll check with staff. I believe we did reach out to this individual. We were made aware that this was going on.
Yeah.
And then we also have another alternative. I'm not prepared this evening to talk about that with council. But we have another alternative we believe is a pretty good location and provides all the space we need. And so I plan on coming into closed and having that conversation possibly with you all, I would say at the next meeting, not this evening, because we still have we have another location that also might work as well. All right.
Thank you.
And I should mention, thank Greg. Greg did, as we were talking, Greg did mention, you all, again, in the essence of time, you actually also have taken one other vote with the $154 million in ARPA funds, which I presented at the retreat, and that was for the broadband ring.
Right?
That was that $6 million for the broadband ring that will connect the high-speed internet throughout the south side. And then other than those votes, the one tonight and that one, all of this has been laid out in the budget retreat, so none of that has changed. And then we just simply will work through to May 10th for the budget adoption. That will take care of all of the capital aspects. And then we have the one last outstanding piece, which I think Greg and I have mentioned we would like to bring that with the budget that night, which is the $13 million in the nonprofit capacity and capability assistance. Now, so I think that would come by way of a separate docket item on the evening of the budget adoption. All the other items will be in the FY23 budget. Yeah, Councilwoman, go ahead.
Yes, thank you. So just for clarity, with RA, which that's the eviction mitigation one, if we vote to approve that one tonight, that will be effective. Those funds will be dispersed immediately.
Immediately, because we have received the first half of our money.
Okay. And then with the other two, because they're not coming directly from us, is that going to be more ARPA money that's going to be kind of added to our fiscal year budget?
No, it'll show up in our budget as an accepted grant.
Okay.
For departmental activities.
All right. So that money won't be allocated still immediately, or?
It will.
Okay.
It will. Yeah. So again, the state has received their tranche of those funds as well, and are passing those through to the grant applicants. So in the case with the VTC money this evening, which I believe is R6. R6 and the behavioral health money, the CSB money, and R5, there it is ARPA funds, but we are not the direct recipient. We're a grantee in that situation.
And those monies have to be allocated for those purposes.
Yeah, so that's really important. And I think that's been lost a little bit in translation. I've been trying to clean that up as well with the public. A good amount of the ARPA funds, and you guys will see these on the docket very frequently coming up over the next several months, as these Commonwealth agencies get together and they start doling out the funds. Almost always these funds will be earmarked funds. They are not fungible. So if you are applying, so if Visit Norfolk is applying through the Tourism Recovery Program for funds from the Virginia Tourism Corporation, those funds have to go to tourism. We can't get those funds and then do other things with those funds. The way you will see this is specific departments will have applied for those grants. The grants are just being made possible with ARPA funds.
And they still have to maintain the same timeline as relates to being spent.
Yes, same time. So the state, that's the state has to maintain that timeline. So we as the recipient have to follow that timeline.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Ms. Johnson.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Manager, I mentioned to Mr. Grid Budget Man Patrick in reference to trying to clearly explain everything to our citizen. And although we have the discussions amongst ourselves, I think that the discussions that we have, we should include them in writing so that it's clearly understood. I mean, because you explaining it, it makes sense. However, I think our citizens also need some guidance as far as where the money comes from. As you have clearly stated, it is a part of the ARPA funding. However, we don't have control over all of the funding. So the question then becomes, what money we do have control over versus the money that has to go through other entities before it comes to the locality, and what it means and what those funding sources are, how they have to be spent, and the timeline. Our discussion is very clear, but many of the questions are coming to us. So I would like to see something put in writing so that it can be a resource and attainable to the citizens of how to understand everything. Because when we talk about ARPA funding, it is perceived that all the money is ours and we can spin it however we want to. But I think your explanation was very clear on what it all means. Thank you so very much, sir, for your consideration.
Yeah, Dr. Fowler, I agree. There may be a way to have a total of $155 million and then list appropriations, for example, the $6 million for the Regional Broadband Authority. the $800,000 for, to extend the eviction mitigation program, $13 million to fund or for nonprofit capacity, and show those three entries, and then as we approve others, and just do a running tab for that. Also, the other pass-throughs or the earmarks, I know that's confusing, but those are grants, those are funds that we receive. They are pass-throughs. We have to accept, but we don't get to decide how that money is spent. If it's for utility assistance, if it's for eviction mitigation, if it's for behavior health, if it's for tourism recovery program, the earmarked, dedicated, we can't do anything about how those monies are used. But we can be crystal clear how the $155 million, and right now there's only three appropriations so far that you have presented us. I think it should maybe be one page somewhere, and everyone can follow how monies are being spent. Mr. Speaker?
You know, whenever we start talking budgets.
Yeah. All right.
All right.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you. All right, moving on. Let's get into the conversation this evening on the budget. Do I have a clicker up here?
It's right here.
As I mentioned, I think given the conversations that I had with council members after following our budget, my initial budget proposal presentation and then the budget hearing the other night, it seemed like this evening's work session would be most valuably spent on the staff compensation actions and the school construction plan. I'm going to start with discussion of some of the staff compensation actions, and then I'm going to hand it over to Greg to get into the details of how we're proposing the funding for the school construction and modernization plan. So the proposed budget work session, yeah, these things never work. Oh, there we go. That picked it up now. Sometimes it just doesn't pick it up. Yeah. Okay, so let me do a brief overview of some of the proposed staff compensation actions. And then I'll pause if we have some questions or comments, and I'll take them at that time. Number one, first and foremost, which I think was the headline of the proposed budget, is a 5% general wage increase across the board for all staff in the city. I think I mentioned in my proposal that is, as far as we can tell, Greg, what was that? That's the largest general wage increase in the last 22 years?
I think since fiscal year 2022, when we did a 7% increase, 2.5%, and a GWI at 4%. So the last 20 years, it's the largest salary increase that we have given across the board.
The other kind of headline was an increase in the minimum wage from $12 to $18. You heard at the budget hearing, there were some folks that were a little concerned about compression. As a result of this, no question, it is this move to what we're referring to as a living minimum wage. Any time we make that move, we are going to create some compression in the early years in some of the departments that have folks in these pay bands. I am suggesting to council, and the reason why we have this proposal in here this fiscal year is that when we have a 5% across the board GWI, it makes it much easier to implement this jump from $12 to $18 as it creates less compression. Then imagine if next year we wanted to try and implement this living minimum wage, and we could only do, say, a 2% or a 3% general wage increase, we would create a far larger compression. So the good news about trying to do this in this fiscal year is that the 5% general wage increase provides us, our existing employees, a much larger bump than normal, which helps to prevent some of the compression that we would see in those early years. I still think this is one of the most important things that we can do for fiscal 23. A lot of our vacancies are in this area and in this range, and I think this gives us a massive competitive advantage over many of the other localities in Hampton Roads in these entry-level positions inside the city.
Yeah. Since you're on this, I wanted to ask, because we had a speaker at the budget hearing that said that their firefighters are making below minimum wage, and I had an opportunity to just stop and talk to Chief DeBacco at the State of the City, and I think there's some confusion. So can you explain that publicly? Because I think the perception's out there that we have firefighters that are making below.
Actually, Greg, you want to go ahead and explain the specifics of it?
So good evening, Mayor, members of council. Thanks for the opportunity to be here. Firefighter scheduling is very much different than almost any other type of employee in that depending on the job that they are working, their work weeks may be either 40 or 52 hours a week. And regardless of which work week that they are working, they get paid the same salary. There are Department of Labor considerations around why this is allowable. A lot of it is they'll spend time in the fire station during those 52-hour weeks, not necessarily on active alert. So when you look at the $18 an hour minimum wage and you multiply that by a 52-hour work week, you get to the point where where the firefighters are making around, I think slightly less, some firefighters at the very beginning of their career are making slightly less than what you would calculate $18 an hour to be against 52-hour work weeks. But it really comes down to the unique nature of firefighter scheduling. So for instance, when I say they're working 52-hour work weeks, they don't earn overtime until they work that 53rd hour. So it is technically correct. It is effectively and meaningfully incorrect to say they're making less than the minimum wage.
If I may, I'm going to set it a little bit differently. Technically, it's in complete compliance with the Fair Labor Standard Act, so that the standards are defined differently for public safety. And so they do work periods where they're in excess of 40 hours a week, and then there are periods where they don't work at all. And so many of them, I'm getting a little bit off subject here, even have second businesses that they operate on the 6 weeks or 2 weeks that they are off. So technically, we are in compliance. And believe you me, if we were out of compliance, the public safety would be the first one to let us know. That it seems that about every 5 years, we get a petition from them that by reason of their answering phone calls or a text or something, that they are working above these federal mandated areas. But we are in technical compliance.
Thank you, Councilman. It is an important distinction, and there is some nuance in it. And thanks, Mr. Pishko, for clarifying as well. I mean, effectively, no, we don't have folks making less than minimum wage.
Will they be above 18 regardless of that? So when you take the salary and divide it on the total amount of hours worked in a year, is it above $18 for the lowest paid firefighters?
Yes, it should be.
Okay.
Yes.
Regardless of the 5240.
Correct.
That's okay.
Correct. Yeah, Councilman.
While we're still on this, how does the, I guess, health insurance play a role in with these pay increases? And are the employees being impacted by that?
So the budget as proposed, and I didn't put this one on here, but one of the compensation actions that I proposed inside the budget for council's consideration is that we do not pass the health insurance premium increases on to the employees, right? So that when I say they are receiving a 5% general wage increase, it is a gross and net 5%. We are not then backing out any increases in healthcare costs or anything like that. And I think that's important. You know, I know over the years in various fiscal environments, sometimes you pass on a general wage increase, but then you also pass on healthcare cost increases, and really nobody sees much difference in their net paycheck. This is going to be a very meaningful difference for a number of employees in the city with their net paycheck. I mean, they are going to see a substantial difference in their net pay. Yeah, so, and that's a good one as well. There is a history, I think, in Norfolk that kind of predates me of doing, what would we call them, Greg? Delayed benefits, delayed compensation actions, where you pass a budget in July with raises or bonuses or something, and they don't kick in until January. So that you only have that first year with 6 months of that impact. These ones I'm recommending, again, to council that we start them in July. And we've budgeted accordingly to begin these pay actions in July.
How could we catch up with our police officers of safety on the steps that we have ignored them for years?
Yeah, so I think we sent out a little primer on pay. There's a bit of a misconception on missing steps. I mean, clearly there have been years where step increases were not given. Maybe GW and general wage increases were given. There was not a step or a general wage increase in the pandemic budget. That was the first budget that I came in on, but that's pretty rare. In most years, there's...
We gave steps from 2015 through 2020. Every year, there was a step increase for police. There was not one in 2021, as stated that year, and there was a general wage last year. And then there was 3 years, 2010, 2011, 2012, that there were no steps given.
So it's, and maybe Councilmember, if I could pause on your question, I'm going to talk a little more specifically about public safety, because I think it is important. There are things we can do that I think folks are talking about concerns they have and not necessarily using the right vernacular. So they're talking about things like compression and things. I think what they're meaning by compression is this issue. Like, well, I'm out of whack with the steps I should be at and so on. Let me pause and I'll get back to that one. The other action that was in the proposed budget was the $5,000 CDL stipend. This one, I know there's been some questions as to, is this necessary? Should we do this? I think when you see some of the media reports that I believe it was Chesapeake just maybe a couple weeks ago reestablished their bulk waste and yard waste pickup after, I believe it was a month maybe, where they were out. I think this is pretty important. We need to plow snow. We need to pick up the trash. I mean, we need these things. When I was thinking about doing this, when Greg and I were considering the budget proposal and putting this in, I was reminded of this Hindu saying that's roughly translated into English that, as important as a thumb is for your hand, a hand with five thumbs isn't a functioning hand either. And so we really do need everything in this city to make the city operate.
right? We need all kinds of services. Every resident gets touched by a myriad number of different folks that work in the city. This one just happens to be a very unique area of the city where we are competing head to head against the private sector for certain. There is no doubt. Amazon and others are going after CDL drivers. And so that's why this might seem like an extremely aggressive stipend, and it is. We believe we have the fiscal capacity to do it and make the commitment, and we think it's a commitment that's probably worth making right now because we are concerned with how the private sector is going after CDL drivers. Correct. So as long as you maintain your licensure, this is a $5,000 stipend to your base pay. Okay, there is an additional pay action that council asked Mr. Patrick and I to consider post-budget proposal. And I think this speaks then directly to Councilman Riddick's comment about, you know, is there a way to move quicker to try and get our public safety personnel back into an environment where we're competitive against some of the other localities? So the additional pay action that is going to be part of the reconciliation process is a 5% across the board general wage increase for public safety, plus a step increase with for personnel with 6+ years of tenure. Those are particularly the staff in public safety that have seen some of these years where they did not receive either a GWI or a step increase. And so the word that folks have used has been compression. I would not necessarily call it compression. What really has happened is we've gotten sort of out of whack with the market, with market wages. This is a massive step back towards getting competitive. This is a 10% pay increase in FY23 for a large number of these folks, and it's a 7.5% wage increase for the others. Steps are, depending on which step you're at, steps are either 5% or 2.5%. What I want to say, and I think it's important to say this publicly, and I know our public safety personnel are very appreciative of this. Many have told me they are extremely appreciative of this. They would like us to try and do more, and I've told every one of them I would also like to do more. But this is a meaningful and measured approach to FY23. One thing that I am very much trying to avoid is constraining the future budgets to the point where we then start missing steps, we start missing GWIs, because that is what has happened in the past. We had a big Thanksgiving dinner and gave a lot of money in one fiscal year, and then we would spend 2 or 3 fiscal years missing steps and missing general wage increases. I think what I'm proposing to the council here with the 5% plus a step, I think it gives Mr. Patrick and I some optimism that in the out years, fiscal 24, 25, 26, we will still have budget capacity to do additional general wage increases or step increases or both. That's what I think is ultimately going to make the public safety personnel feel better.
Milo, are you going to, that language you just shared, are you going to include that language in this budget?
The, which language?
That the outgoing years, your intentions are to provide the additional steps without...
I think within the budget, the 5-year out budget forecast, I can provide you with budget surplus deficit numbers based on, you know, assuming we do a step in FY 24, 25, 26, right? I mean, we have that capacity to do that.
In the final budget.
Correct. So that we can say in the budget, here is what's going to happen in FY24. This is what we expect it to look like. Obviously, standing here today, this is what we would expect FY24 to look like with a step for all public safety in the FY24 budget.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Ms. Johnson.
Thank you for your comment, because I made note of it. If the city manager, because he thinks in a forward mindedness, is that we look beyond our yearly budgets as far as addressing the GWI and the step increase for our public safety workers. It says that this council is willing to go beyond just a yearly plan to address the needs as far as salary increases and step increases are concerned, but it gives us some type of guidance and a master plan. Now, should it have to change, that's something different, but at least it helps to guide us as we move forward year after year with the understanding this is our plan for the future. We mentioned that this was the largest salary increase since 2004. Well, I think what happened with that is due to us planning on a yearly basis and not having all the data that was necessary for us to plan in the future. But since now we have the data that is needed, I think that we can plan beyond a year's budget and moving forward with salary increases as well as step increases. So thank you both, Mr. Manager and Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Yeah, so I need an explanation and then I have two comments.
Okay.
So when I'm looking at the document you gave us, mm-hmm. which was very helpful, thank you for putting
Absolutely.
That together.
No problem.
And this helps me as I'm meeting with police officers explaining some of the language, as you said, that's not being used correctly. So there is a grade of 1, 2, 3, 4. A police officer is on 4. When you say police officer, if there is a recruit in the academy, they're on grade 1. When they get sworn in, do they jump from 1 to 4?
Absolutely, yes.
So there's no 2 and 3 grade.
No, so public, correct. So what if you look right underneath that table, Councilman, what we tried to do, so I think this is a really important point that I want to say, because it has to be mentioned. The pay plan is a public safety pay plan. Right, so this is Norfolk Fire Rescue, NP Norfolk Police Department, and the Sheriff's Office. So you have multiple grades in there because we do have positions in fire that might be in a 2 and a 3. You may have nobody in police at a 2 or a 3. Right, so what we tried to do with the table underneath is give you a visual of where the departments line up relative to grades.
Okay. So then the next question is about the recruit salary.
Right.
So I noticed that in the tables you gave us that we are very competitive except in two areas. The first area is in the recruit classification, in which we seem to be just the third lowest in the area behind Portsmouth and Chesapeake. Has there been discussion about changing that, or because if you change that, it ends up impacting the rest of your scale?
Yeah, so you answered your own quite right, correct.
Are we doing the signing bonuses if a recruit completes the academy?
What is
that one?
It's a $5,000 signing bonus.
Anybody who comes into the academy.
Correct.
Okay, so that's not included in the 43
no,
that's listed
no,
here, but
no.
It is...
That would be a bonus that would be payable on the completion of the academy,
okay.
Correct.
I just want to make sure that when we're advertising for recruits, because I, for some reason, I guess because I've been looking up police salaries on Facebook,
yeah.
Facebook is now I'm always getting the City of Norfolk Police Department ads. It doesn't say that. So I'm not seeing that in the language that's going out from us in recruiting on that.
Okay.
And then if you were to compare us, we look bad compared to other localities on that
recruit. At the recruit level,
yes.
Yeah.
So we really need to push the $5,000 bonus on there. It doesn't hurt us. We're doing it, right? If
right.
we can fill up our 30 and 30 each half year in the recruit class, we need to try to make that effort. The second thing is that, and we've discussed the master police salary that's missing, that is the area that's there. You're going to talk about that? Okay.
I'll put it up, though. Go ahead.
I'm leading into it. I know that you said that you've asked Chief Goldsmith to bring this. Are we talking about this budget year doing this?
So,
I know you're running out of time.
No, no, no. So here's the beauty of this. When Greg and I first started having this conversation, and we started looking at the data on police compensation, as I'm saying here on the slide, our comparisons when you get into officers at rank are strong, very strong. We are very, very strong. And where we are weak is for our officers with about 8 and 15 years of tenure that do not get promoted up into a rank. And initially we felt like, well, that might have been because we missed some steps or we missed some GWIs. We got to catch them up. After we dug a little bit deeper, what we realized is where we are really getting hurt against some of the neighboring localities is particularly Virginia Beach and Hampton. Both have what's called a master police officer designation in their departments. This is an enhanced pay scale for a non-rank officer with a pretty good amount of tenure in the department. So what I have asked Interim Chief Goldsmith to do is move on this at light speed. We tried to do this last year. In fact, we went so far as to add the grade into the public safety pay plan. I mean, it is there. It is sitting there. It's grade 6. And so grade 6 could immediately just become that. I just really need input from the police department on what that looks like. How do you get that? Is it merit-based? Are there licensing and things that a chief would particularly value? And at the same time, I've asked Chief DeBacco to do the same and think about a master firefighter. Theirs might be a little less necessary because firefighters have the unique promotional process to EMT, which then opens up sort of a whole different path. Where I think we're really struggling in the police department and the majority of the folks that are saying they are behind, to Councilman Riddick's point, is that when they see themselves as a 15-year officer, not moving to captain or lieutenant, like I'm not going that direction, I'm an officer, and they go to Virginia Beach, that could be an $8,000 or $9,000 difference in pay if that officer in Virginia Beach at the same tenure is a master police officer.
So my question can't we just vote on that now and you guys work out the specifics?
It's done.
Of how
it's done.
Is it in our budget?
It's done. That's in the comp plan. Grade 6 is there.
Okay, so it does, just on what you provided us, it doesn't say master. Can you put that in there as master without knowing yet how many are there? You'll have some vacancy savings that you could probably end up applying later once they work out how they qualify for this.
The goal is to bring that plan back to you before you vote on budget.
Okay. Okay.
That's really what we're hoping for. I think we can get there. We had made a ton of progress, and we're making progress and trying to figure out what that would look like. That's why last year's comp plan, we went ahead and put the grade in there because I felt like last fiscal year, I thought we would get there. And we didn't, but this is critical. I mean, this really is critical in terms of
competitiveness for Norfolk Police Department, as well as Norfolk Fire Rescue. I need to talk to Chief DeBacco on sort of what this means for fire rescue. But for police, there is absolutely no question that this would go a long way. I mean, this is about a $7,000 to $9,000 bump for these officers in this space from this program.
And I understand there's also Joe and the sheriff's.
Yeah, we do need
the gaps that occur between his.
We need to talk about an equivalent, what that would look like in sheriff as well. Yes. Yeah. Thank you for mentioning that. So that is something, and I am sure you all remember this. Every once in a while, as you can tell, I forget. One of the budget actions that council took last year in the mid-year was to put the sheriff's office in the public safety pay plan, which I think was a brilliant move. I think it was a long time coming. And so then that means for this type of a classification, we'll also need to work with Sheriff Barron and figure out what that looks like for his department as well.
Sorry.
Okay, Councilman Riddick, that's really all I've got on the pay action material for tonight. You have the document that I sent you. If you have further questions on that, please let me know. Ultimately, in the reconciliation process, what I'll ask you to consider is the additional step for all of the public safety personnel, 6+ years of tenure, in addition to the 5%. I will also ask we will bring back to you what the classification for master police officer, master firefighter, and master sheriff look like. And then that way, we already have the grade. We don't have to adjust the comp plan, but then you will know exactly how we're going to determine folks that are eligible for that category. I really believe that is a big change to the department, particularly the police department, for competitiveness. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention there are a number of other things that we're talking about on the back end, none of which I think we will be able to do the math fast enough to consider in this budget. Really, the MPO is the biggest thing for this budget. But there are some other retirement things and other things that officers have come to me and said, you know, Dr. Fowler, were you aware that, you know, we had this cap or we had this max? And I was aware, and I know those things were put in there, I think, with good intentions and for meaningful purposes. I think it's fair to say that the environment has changed and it's time to reevaluate everything in terms of what may have been put in previous years and whether or not those are policy decisions that still make sense in the labor market for public safety that we face currently. Yeah.
Classification that will also be into effect July 1 as well?
Yes, we can put that into effect. Yeah. Yeah, once we figure out what it looks like and how we would implement it, we would be able to then cost out what the budgetary impact would be.
I just don't want to see that delayed.
I would prefer that it not be delayed any longer. Okay, with that, Mayor, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Patrick. The announcement that the mayor made at the State of the City was, as I mentioned, was historic. We believe assuredly, we believe, and we'll show you the math here, that we have a unique opportunity to make a generational change in the facilities of the Norfolk Public School System, both through new construction as well as massive modernization and renovation. And the path to that involves no fee increases, no increases in taxes. It does, however, involve an earmark, so to speak, of a certain revenue stream. But I think, as I'll be able to show you here, as Greg will be able to show you, the math works and we can do this. And this is something that we definitely would want to embed in our budget and get council approval on as soon as possible, if you all are comfortable with this. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Patchett.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Again, very very excited to be with you tonight to talk about the school construction program. This is something we've been working on for a long time, and I think we've got a unique opportunity to really make some progress here that we've just not been able to do in the past. It is truly an opportunity to make meaningful generational impact on Norfolk Public School facilities. Ms. Johnson, before I get started, I do have to say every time you call me budget man, it makes me think that I'm the world's most boring superhero. to get started, as an overview and sort of bottom line up front, what this funding program would provide is about $250 million every 10 years, or about $25 million a year for new school construction. As the city manager says, it requires no tax or fee increases. It is built around an economic model that makes certain assumptions, so we do have to monitor that we are achieving the assumptions, but it does not require any tax or fee increases. It will transition the debt service costs for existing debt service expenses related to NPS from the city to Norfolk Public Schools to align with the best practices of other regional cities. It will dedicate casino revenue to debt service for school construction at the 29.55% split that we have established in the school funding formula. No funds currently planned for school maintenance, including any federal stimulus funding, are transitioned to school construction as a result of the plan, and it does maintain compliance with the city's debt affordability measures. First, let's take a look at the construction funding and those funding sources. Those funding sources, $25 million annually, and what we are looking at is $22 million in debt and $3 million we would make an assumption of reversion funds coming from Norfolk Public Schools. And I think it's important to say that this is a plan that we have not developed in a vacuum. We have worked with Norfolk Public Schools, the administration over there, their financial team, Dr. Birdsong, there are some details we still need to hammer out, but suffice to say, both our administration, the city manager, and their administration are very supportive of the plan going forward. Now, one question you'll probably ask is, if we are allocating $25 million a year to school construction, if we have a large project like a high school to build, do we have to wait 6 years to save up the money in order to start construction on that high school? The answer is no. The way debt and debt service functions in the background is there's always a lag between authorization and the issuance of the debt. And we would take advantage of, to the extent that our finance department was able to structure the debt to allow us to take advantage of that lag, we would certainly do so. The best thing we have going for us is that Christine Garzinski, in our finance director, is the one who will manage the back end here, and there is literally no one better in the country doing that type of work. So debt service funding. This is really the sort of most important change I think that we'll see in the plan. So it permanently transitions responsibility for all NPS-related debt service costs, both construction and maintenance, from the city to Norfolk Public Schools. In fiscal year 2023, we have about $18.2 million in our debt service budget that goes to pay debt service costs for NPS-related capital investments. So that debt service budget would be reduced by that amount, and the city contribution, it would exist outside of the funding formula, but that city contribution to NPS would be increased by $18.2 million. And the beauty of that is we would not lower that contribution over time to correspond with the level of debt service related to the current Norfolk Public Schools capital investments that we've made. So as those, as a debt service cost related to investments that we've already made reduce, go down, that creates capacity for more investment in school construction or school maintenance. We would dedicate gaming revenue and other local revenue generated within the casino footprint to fund NPS-related debt service, again, at the established 29.55% split. Right now, we estimate the casino to open on July 1, 2024, which is the first day of fiscal year 2025. Our baseline revenue projection, and we'll provide more information on an upcoming slide, our baseline revenue projection yields about $10 million annually for Norfolk Public Schools debt service from the casino at that split. We would then create a debt service reserve. This is an action we would ask council to take. What we'll find is revenues that we are going to dedicate to support debt service will exceed expenses in the short run. But as we issue $25 million or authorize $25 million of debt each year, it will catch up. So that reserve can be used to help mitigate that increase in debt service as we pay off Norfolk Public Schools' existing capital investments. And then it would have to be a city-held reserve because of state guidelines with respect to how reversion funding works. But we would work in conjunction with Norfolk Public Schools to make sure we're all on the same page there.
Great.
Yes, sir.
Have any facilities or schools been identified?
Yes, sir. And slide, I believe the 10th slide here will have a preliminary funding plan.
Ms. Royster.
And with the casino having the ability to kind of open their temporary, will the funds that they, the revenue generated, start to flow into this pot of money that we're discussing to help with the construction of the schools?
We would recommend that any gaming revenue, that council dedicate any gaming revenue beginning July 1, 2022, so with this upcoming fiscal year, be dedicated for this purpose and begin accruing in the debt service reserve as soon as we generate that revenue.
It's not a huge amount. Was it $4 million a year?
Yeah, the total.
But that's
the temporary facility is pretty small. It's going to be nice. There's no question. And it's going to generate maybe about $4 to $5 million in gaming revenue, of which then the 29.5% split would come out of that.
All right, so it is going to go there.
And the sense of urgency
we,
here,
yeah, go ahead.
Is. If the casino opens and we use that revenue, we begin to use that revenue for another purpose, it's hard to claw it back and then use it for this purpose. So we want to make sure that if council supports this plan, that we take the actions that we need to take as soon as possible to begin setting aside that revenue in the way that supports this plan.
Just real quick, Mr. Riddick, there's what this does not include is they have $75 million in federal government funds from the, it's called ESSER, it's their version of ARPA, that they're putting towards 29 schools. And I don't know if that's in your 10th slide or not. So when there are schools that are receiving millions of dollars and upgrades to HVAC systems, windows, doors, and roofs as part of that. And I believe it's 29 schools total. In fact, I think in their plan, they've got Booker T getting close to $35 million in funds and renovations to the building with ARPA and some of the funding that's coming in regular maintenance.
Did they say why they didn't come to the budget hearing?
They had a meeting.
I mean, well, you know, and I know this is...
I expressed your concern to them.
You know, why would they schedule a meeting when, you know, In 30 years, this is the first time I've ever seen them not come.
I don't know. I shared your same concern.
Okay, thank you.
Craig, can I also add to that?
Ms. Doyle.
In addition, what the schools going to receive funding from the state from generating casino revenue joint to the state that's also going to come back to schools?
I believe so, but I'm not certain enough on the language to
give. You're not banking on it.
Right,
so,
exactly.
So this plan assumes no legislation that establishes a school construction program at the state level, no funding from the lottery board into, that this plan does not include. Any of that would be above and beyond.
But then they can use this, if we vote on it, to leverage money that could come from the state and could end up doubling some project, like if we have to match on that, or if they end up borrowing money from the state fund, it might be 0% interest or whatever they're gonna end up doing with this pot of money, but they can't decide what they're gonna do in Richmond.
The point is, it's independent of any other, which is important for people to know that this is not at risk for any other effort.
Correct.
As long as we hit close to our assumptions, we are not reliant on anyone other than ourselves to make this happen.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Ms. Johnson.
Thank you, sir. At the budget hearing, we heard from a lot of citizens as well as teachers, and I think that we do owe a response. The question was if it was possible not to accept the school's budget. And from the employee standpoint, it was because of teacher salaries as well as step increase. So I think that we need to address that question to the general public. The other question is, how is the school addressing the city council's ask? There are certainly things that we've asked of the school system in reference to the schools that are still online but are not in use. I want to know where do we fall as far as the school board addressing our ask as a city council, the governing body? And number three, how does the school system plan and or in partnership with the city council to address teacher salaries and steps? Thank you so very much. Do I need to repeat those questions or did you get them all?
Dr. Fowley said he has them all.
We're good.
Thank you.
Yeah, I will, I think I'm gonna let Greg go with this. Some of those questions, Councilwoman Johnson, are obviously operating budget questions that I want to address kind of separately from the capital question here. The one that you mentioned that is definitely a capital question is, what about schools that aren't being utilized? You know, are they coming back to us? What about other schools? So, you know, we had a long conversation with the administration about the schools that were not being utilized, were closed, you know, what the plans were for those, as well as some of the schools coming up that are thinking of potentially closing and so on. And we had some good conversations with all of that. I would say this to the council, how we adopt this and memorialize this is really up to the council. If there are things that we would like to see, check-ins every 5 years before, you know, new debt gets issued and debt service flows over. I mean, all of those things I think are on the table. How we actually operationalize this plan is really, you guys have to provide that guidance to Greg and I. Tonight really was about the math works, and this is an opportunity for us here. So, Councilwoman, I would add to your comment or your question, the schools that are out there floating around, things that have been proposed potentially build new, things that have had proposals for major renovation, all of that. We did have very good conversations with the administration about those plans. I think Greg and I both, I think we were very clear with the administration that there was some frustration on the council side that proposals and recommendations had been given and there wasn't much follow through on those recommendations, and that was fine. If those weren't good recommendations, then what were the new recommendations? But that, you know, at some point before we could launch a program like this, there had to be a path forward for the next 10 years on what schools were getting closed, what schools were getting built, what schools were getting renovated. I mean, that was going to have to be part of this.
Thank you, Mr. Manager, for addressing that. But from my standpoint, the City Council has priority asked of the school system. And from what I'm seeing, those priorities have not been addressed. The first priority is to our scholars. We know that we need to do more for the children. We're coming out of a pandemic, and Norfolk Public Schools, as well as the City Council, has the data to show that we have great challenges. And so moving forward, I would like for us as a governing body to get it in writing what our priorities are for the City Council, for the school board, so there's no misunderstandings nor miscommunications, as well as whatever is proposed or stated from the school board. I would like, in moving forward, that we get everything in writing. It's no more what we believe to be the understanding or what we believe that is going to happen. I think everything needs to be documented moving forward. We're dealing with a lot of money. We have shown that we're committed. We are committed to the children and their families, to the teachers, and all of the employees of the Norfolk Public Schools. However, we do not control how the money is spent. And no matter how many times we make that statement, the citizens are still holding us, this governing body, accountable for the success and failure of Norfolk Public Schools. Although they are elected, they look for us for the guidance. So those are just some of my suggestions, and that we, the council, be updated on a regular basis as far as what is happening with Norfolk Public Schools. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Manager and Mr. Mayor.
Just going back to what you're saying about codifying a few things, I do believe this council still has not put in writing that when they do turn over a school building to us, that when it's sold, that the money that's made from the sale of the property should go back into their regular maintenance fund. One of the things that I have heard from a few school board members is there is a reduction in the general maintenance dollars. So even though we're putting a significant amount of money in there in our future budget, which I don't have my budget book in front of me, I have been carrying that with me everywhere I go, to lift weights. We reduce it back down to $3 million a year. And so to help them continue keeping up with their maintenance needs or regular maintenance needs, I think that that's a simple thing that we could add into our language as we're codifying this agreement, that we could do that. I mean, most of those properties probably only generated about $500,000, but that $500,000 could make a big difference in replacing roofs, or not really roofs anymore because they're expensive, but doors, windows, and things like that. I think that would be a no-brainer to put that in there, particularly because they are going to be closing some buildings soon and giving them back to the city, and we should do that. I don't agree, though. There was a previous school board member who's left that was saying that the money that's generated from taxes and stuff that are on that site should go 100% to the schools. I think, as I've explained, we have the funding formula for that reason. So the funding formula, whatever's taxes are generated, should go to the schools from that.
All right, Dr. Filer.
All right, go ahead.
Mr. Spiegel, you mentioned the funding formula. I just a plug. That is an unmitigated success that this council has. It has made working with the school system and budgeting for school funding just incredibly easier, more straightforward, and has improved relationships dramatically. So thank you very much for that. Again, I said budget management is boring. Here we go. I'll look at some of the numbers. We'll start with assumptions. So again, this is built on a financial model, an economic model. So a couple of the important numbers and decision points that are made in the model. First of all, our debt service to debt ratio at 8%, essentially what this means is for every $1 million of debt that we issue, we're assuming that the debt service costs are about $80,000. Next, our authorization to issuance lag. This is the difference between when council authorizes the issuance of debt to when the debt is actually issued. We're assuming about a three-year lag there. And then, yes, we are transferring all funding that goes to the current level of debt service for NPS-related debt from the city to Norfolk Public Schools, and we are not reducing that as it begins to be paid off. Dedicated revenue, we are dedicating gaming revenue at the formula rate, and we are dedicating other local revenue generated on the casino footprint at the formula rate of 29.55%. We are assuming that our annual assessed value growth, now this is not just real estate, this is the assessed value of all property in the city, will grow at about 2.5% per year, and that the general fund budget will grow at about 2% per year. And then one of the most important aspects of this program is one of the items that we are doing to make sure this remains affordable is transferring a portion of the debt affordability measures that City Council has put in place in their financial policies to Norfolk Public Schools. So there are two very important debt affordability measures in City Council's financial policies. The first is total debt or debt to total assessed value. And that can't exceed 3.5% of our total debt can't exceed 3.5% of our total assessed value across the city. We would transition about 1% of that 3.5% to Norfolk Public Schools, and that is the affordability measure that they would need to maintain. The next is council's financial policies state that debt service costs can't exceed more than 10% of the general fund budget. We would transition 3% of that 10% to Norfolk Public Schools, and essentially creating debt affordability measures for NPS. And as we go forward, we'll see how this plan and those debt affordability measures interact. Oops, looks like the clicker may have frozen here. Dania. Oh, that was not the right button. There we go. Next, if you look at the slide here, just to recall our projections for casino revenue, Dr. Filer built these projections 2.5 years ago. Now there was a baseline, an optimistic and a pessimistic scenario, and we are using the baseline scenario for our calculations here. And then a look at the numbers, NPS debt. You all have a handout in front of you that has a little bit more information than what I was able to fit on the slides, but I wanted to provide some information around the total level of debt at NPS and what this program is going to mean, and then the same from a debt service standpoint. So right now, there is between debt that we have issued and bonds that have been authorized but unissued, so BAU, there is almost $190 million of debt outstanding related to Norfolk Public Schools. You can see on the slide how that begins to reduce over the next 5 years. And then you can also see on the second row of that first table the new debt service costs, or the new debt. It says new debt service costs. I think this is this may have been a slightly older version of the presentation
I
here.
I edited that as well. I edited down, and I guess I left the old slide in there. Sorry.
But that is actually new debt. So you can see beginning in 2025, $25 million a year coming online, and that $25 million in 2026, it's not $50 million. You'd think, why is that not $50 million? Well, we begin paying off some of that debt, so it doesn't increase exponentially. And then if we look at projected debt service costs, you see the same concept. You see as we look forward over the 5 years on the slide, you can see what that debt service costs look like based on existing debt. And then you can see the new debt service costs come online. If you look at the sheet that I've provided here, we provide, it includes additional years of information out to fiscal year 2052 or over the next 30 years in 5 year increments. And you really begin to see the current debt service costs go down, and then the new debt service costs begin to increase. Again, this slide provides much of the same information, but it is related to the revenue that would be available to Norfolk Public Schools for the payment of debt service. Important thing to remember here, you have the current debt service amount that is not in CTI, which is the Construction, Technology, and Infrastructure Fund. That is the 2 cents of the 4 cent tax increase council provided in fiscal year 2014 to increase the pace at which we could build the five elementary schools that were underway. That's CTI. And then this is the current non-CTI debt service costs. What you'll see here is the current non-CTI debt service costs we will transfer to schools in perpetuity. But those CTI funds continue to grow throughout the 30 years in this plan. And then the dedicated revenue from the casino comes online in 2025 and continues to grow through the 30 years in the plan. Bottom level here, you can see how the debt service reserve begins to quickly pick up funds, because in the early years, there is a lot more revenue to pay for debt service than there are debt service expenses. So that debt service reserve really picks up steam in the early years until we start using it in the later years of the plan. On your worksheet, you can see a little bit further into the future. Again, a look at the numbers. So these are the results over 30 years, and some of the high-end results that I think are really important here. First and foremost, our debt affordability measures, debt service to budget, debt service or debt to AV. Do we remain in compliance based on our assumptions over 30 years? Yes. Yes, we do. Our highest debt service to budget ratio we're projecting is 2.84%, so not quite 3% limit, and we don't hit that until fiscal year 2025. We don't get any higher than 0.74% of our debt to assessed value, and that's in 2031. And then our max debt service, we don't hit until 2047. At that point, schools would be required, based on the model, to kick in some of their normal formula funds to help pay for debt service costs. That actually begins to tail off as you go from 47 to 52, but that is a problem to address in 25 years. And believe me, the assumptions will change tomorrow, let alone 25 years from now.
So Mr. Riddick, this is the preliminary 10-year construction plan. There's a couple of big asks from schools in here, and I will say the dates are very much still preliminary. However, these are the schools that NPS has prioritized in our conversations. The one big ask is that in fiscal 23, we provide substantial, meaningful design funds for Morey High School, and our plan to construct would be 2 years down the road in fiscal year 2025. We don't want to begin the construction or fund the construction of any schools before the casino comes online. Casino is scheduled to come online in fiscal year 2025. A major renovation of Booker T. Washington, a replacement of Norview Elementary, and then replacement or full renovation of Jaycox and Granby Elementary are sort of the tentative preliminary thinking over the course of the next 10 years.
What's the amount for Morey?
So I think what we've heard for a couple of 4 or 5 years now is about $150 million. I think everyone's thinking that number's probably closer to $180 at this point. I think as we move forward, as we emerge from the pandemic, we're going to see what the impact on construction prices is. Have we sort of reached a new a level of equilibrium, or are we still at elevated levels? And I think that's going to play a role in where we end up there.
So as far as Morey is concerned, you know, it's already a handsome architecture. I mean, there's no, they won't do anything to try to keep the culture, you know, architectural culture there. Or does anybody know now?
So the answer from the budget guy is their top priority is addressing the unsafe conditions at Morey High School in the most effective way. They need money, and we've found a way to provide the money. I think that is a question for the school board.
So as far as Booker T. Washington is concerned, you know, it's always going to be us against them. you can't get a new BTW.
So again,
I mean, it's up to the school. It's up to the school board.
Yeah, I think that initially the conversation on Morey was replace or fully renovate, and I gotta be honest, I don't know that they've figured that out yet with the engineers. Like, is there an opportunity to save it? My understanding from the school administration is Booker T was originally going to be some cosmetic renovation. I think that number is going to be closer now, Greg, to what? What are we thinking? Like 50, 60,
40 to 60.
You know, $40 to $60 million of major renovation to Booker T. So apparently, what the school administration is saying is the envelope of Booker T is still good.
The
bones of it are fine, but it needs a major renovation. So whereas before I think they were thinking using ESSER funds and putting a new roof on it and stuff like, now in this plan, this could potentially provide up to about $50 to $60 million for a full renovation of Booker T.
What about the CTIs or the CTI school?
Yeah, the CTE.
I
don't have any additional insight on that at this point. I know we did not receive the funding last year for that. So,
okay, thank you.
But I wouldn't say that. I don't know. I think a good question, and I'm happy to talk to Dr. Birdsong. A good question would be if we're in the $50 to $60 million range for a full renovation of Booker T. Is that renovation being done in a manner where Booker T could potentially then host a CTE on the back end? I think that's a fair question. I'm happy to ask her that question. I don't know that they know the answer to that right now, but I do know they have definitely changed from $10, $15 million cosmetic upgrade of Booker T to a massive renovation of Booker T.
They need to have, Paul, they need to have discussions. Sorry, Mr. Ritt. I had this conversation with Rodney recently, Tanya Bassine, and Noel and Adele. I, you know, looking at the, I watch every school board meeting, I look at the numbers from the consultants, there is not a need for five high schools in Norfolk anymore. The numbers are so low that maintaining five high schools doesn't make sense, right? So, you know, the Lake Taylor building itself is, they just put a new roof on it. They put a lot of money into it. That building could be repurposed into a better CTE school or something like that, but they really have to have the political fortitude to want to go to the public and say this. And I, as everybody saw what happened just trying to close Lindenwood Elementary School, people go crazy over closing buildings. And it's a hard thing for school board members, just in my conversations with them, to come out and say that. And I don't blame them. I mean, Kenny's alma mater would probably be on the chopping block if they had to make a decision. And that's hard. There's alumni, there's people out there that are, you know, proud of their schools. But at the same time, nobody can find teachers. It's not just Norfolk anymore. You know, we're keeping buildings open on with staff that, you know, they can't hire teachers. And so why do we keep on holding buildings? And it's not just high schools. It's middle schools. It's elementary schools. It's all of them. There really needs to be a right sizing, very similar to what we've talked about in the city with our own buildings, on what are we providing to the communities and best. And I think these are great schools. It's particularly the elementary. Norview is the has the highest child population in the city, if you were to look at heat maps. And so that elementary school is bursting at the seams and needs a new building, and they could probably build a very nice sized building that can accommodate the population in that area. Same thing with Granby and Jaycox. Those are actually, I think the bones in those buildings are fairly good too. They were built back in the days, bomb shelters, so they can hold up to anything. But, you know, we really just need the school system to continue their work with the consultant and guide and tell us what's right. And we really should be supporting them, you know, and that's hard for us too. But if they come back to us and say, hey, we need to close a high school, and they make the decision on which one to close, if it makes sense, we should be supporting them. And that is a hard thing to any school system to say they're going to close a school. But it just makes sense. We just can't keep buildings open to keep them open, you know, when they're not functioning at capacity.
Yes, Ms. Johnson.
Go back to that slide, please. Greg, thank you. When we're looking at closing of schools, it really is a difficult decision, because then that's when the question becomes about equity and the extended bus rides of certain children. Well, when we look at the equity, we have to look at it from a standpoint that both sides of the city have to be willing that there's a possibility that their children will need to be bused. That's where the equity side of things come in. You can't close certain schools on one side of the city where on another side of the city, children continue to go to their neighboring nice schools. You have to, it's a hard decision, but we're going to have that discussion, as well as Norfolk Public Schools, about the equity part of it. What does it all mean? And if we can continue to work together, I think that we can get to that point as far as the closing of schools, what schools may need to be taken offline. But you have to include that equity standpoint as well. And I do believe that we can get to that point, but it has to be some hard conversation with the city council as well as the school board, and getting to what the priorities are. And our priorities are all of our children, no matter where you live. So thank you so very much, Mr. Mayor and Mr. City Manager.
So again, monitoring results versus projections is critical.
Delay casino opening means delay in construction timeline, variability in construction cost, impact capacity, variance in actual revenues versus projected revenues, that impacts debt capacity. And then any state actions that are related to school construction, we're going to want to take a look at and compare against the plan and make sure we're still heading in the right direction. Required council action.
Greg?
Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me, sir. I do have one more question. Going back to the schools, when they're talking about the replacement of Jay Cox Elementary, has the decision been made from the school board where the Jay Cox Elementary school will be replaced? What site? Is it where it is? Is it on the Globe Iron site? Where? Have we gotten that information from the school board? Because we really do need, that's a crucial point as far as Bruce's part and the plans and moving forward to the for the greater Broad Creek area. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. The no. So the administration has not, at least to us, has not said it would be a new construction or a full renovation. I believe both options are on the table: a fully renovated Jay Cox on its current footprint, or a possible new Jay Cox, which would be on a different footprint. I think both options are still on the table. Thank you, ma'am.
And finally, required council action. There's more in this presentation than you will typically see. First, amending the operating and capital budgets to reflect what we've gone through. Secondly, an ordinance or resolution, whatever Mr. Pishko would recommend, to dedicate the casino related revenue to be used for debt service. And then finally,
we can discuss that.
An ordinance or resolution to establish a policy on the debt service reserve for school construction, and then to amend the city's financial policies to allocate a portion of the debt service, debt affordability measures to.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you very much. Mr. Budget Man, thank you.
Thanks, Greg.
I fear that one may stick.
Hero, man.
All right, sir. Next up, we have Mr. Homewood with the planning update.
Following Greg is never a good thing, that's for sure. An even more boring superhero.
George goes, I just want to make sure I have a better understanding of our budget talks. So when I see budget, you know, talks number one on here, this has happened in the past, and I appreciate you, Greg, you know, the budget man. But I don't always just want to be talked to about budget. I think that when are we going to get to talk to each other about budget and our ideas and plans? So I just want to make sure that time is built in there.
Those are
important updates. But in the past, we've been able to go around the table and talk about things at the meeting that are a concern in the budget to give you time to process it. I know we have our one-on-ones and it was great. Our meeting was great. But I think publicly too, I just want to make sure my colleagues know of concerns and things that I may have with the budget. I want to hear from them about it. We do talk to each other, but it would be better for us to have this. So, Mr. Mayor, I don't know. I didn't want to stop the manager on what you're doing, but at the same time, I hope we have that opportunity.
We did do that one for a work session, too. Yeah, for sure.
Okay.
We're good to go. All right. Dr. Mayor, members of council, Dr. Filer, thank you for having me. I will attempt to speed this up as much as I possibly can. Although I'm going to go off script at the very beginning and tell you a couple of things. First, we're really excited that last night at 6 o'clock we went live with the portal upgrades. So now 100% of building permits and building applications are done through the portal. So we finally are where we've said we wanted to be with the 2 a.m. entrepreneur. You can apply for a building permit at 24/7, 365 from anywhere in the world that there's an internet connection. And we're thrilled to be there. By the end of the month, all of the rest of the planning applications except application for conditional use permits and rezonings will also be online through the portal. So we will finally meet the promise that we started 7 years ago, and we're thrilled at that. And with that, we'll move on to the rest. If the clicker works. Can you advance the slides? All right. That may be easier than me trying to click through it. So next slide, please. So I want to talk about a couple of items that are coming to you at your next meeting. The first one is a zoning text amendment to eliminate virtually all of the parking, off-street parking requirements in the Norfolk and Western Historic Overlay. This was something that was requested by the Business Association there. And what this does is for properties that are have been rezoned into that district. Next slide, please. The overlay, this is a floating district. So the area where you can ask for rezoning is specified on the map. It's those two historic areas. But you have to ask to be rezoned into it. Otherwise, you keep your existing zoning, which in most cases is industrial. And so it will only apply to those properties that have been rezoned into the historic overlay. One of the things that comes with that is a great deal of flexibility on uses, but it also comes with that's the carrot. The stick is properties have to go through the design review process, the certificate of appropriateness process, because it is tantamount to a local historic district. Next slide, please.
So, what's that
made? Yes, sir.
Where we see the yellow, you say as far as off-street parking, talk to me again.
Okay, so the yellow there is the Norfolk and Western Railroad Historic District. The blue-green is the Williamston Woodland Historic District. When we created the historic overlay, the Norfolk and Western Historic Overlay, it includes all of the properties in both of those National Register Historic Districts. What would happen is if you have rezoned your property from the underlying industrial, in most cases, into that district, then and only then would the parking requirement be removed.
So you still have on-street parking or no on-street?
On-street parking would still be there. This is the off-street parking, the minimum off-street parking requirement. And it doesn't say you can't build parking. It just says that the city isn't going to tell you precisely how many spaces it has to be. And what this does is this helps with affordable housing. It helps with the adaptive reuse. It's really protects the historic urban fabric of the area. I mean, what we don't want is people having to tear down buildings in order to put up a parking lot. Is that what, Pave Paradise put up a parking lot? No, I'm sorry.
So how long has that been historic?
2015, I believe, was when the first district went into place, and then the second one was about a year later. And then there's also the Auto Row District that sort of extends a little further to the south. That these are National Register Historic Districts. Now, the city knows about them, but the city isn't involved in actually creating those districts or implementing things. Remember that a National Register Historic District has no requirements to protect anything. It is basically provides the opportunity to apply for historic tax credits.
Thank you.
Is that clear, sir?
Yes, sir.
Thanks. All right. So the next slide, the proposal, it applies only to property that's been rezoned, as I mentioned. And it applies only to residential uses that have less than 25 units. You'll recall we have a conditional use permit requirement for multifamily of 25 units and more. There was a great concern that if you had no parking and a large number of residential units being constructed, that that could in fact gobble up the existing on-street parking and create parking concerns. So this does only apply to all non-residential uses, and then residential uses of 24 units and fewer. And as I mentioned, eliminating the requirement will not eliminate parking. People, the marketplace will determine how many parking spaces. I mean, one of the things we find is in downtown, you don't have to have parking, and yet all of the residential units provide parking because, among other things, they can't get it financed without having parking for their tenants. Next slide, please. So the Planning Commission unanimously recommends the approval of this. The Railroad District Business Association is fully supportive and strongly supportive, and the Architecture Review Board also voted unanimously to recommend approval. It goes to the Architecture Review Board because it's a historic district, and our ordinance requires anything goes on in a historic district has to go to the ARB. All right, item number two is a conditional use permit for a short-term rental by Quan Lee. I bring this one to you. It is in Ocean View. It is like many of the other short-term rentals we've seen recently in Ocean View. It's an existing five-bedroom home. But in this case, next slide, please. During the public hearing, I'm sorry, there we go. During the public hearing, the neighboring property owners indicated that.
One person.
I think it was two, but.
Husband.
I don't know. I think it was. Might have been. Yes, sir. Indicated that this property had already been operated as a short-term rental, and there had been some issues with the site. If you go to the next slide, please. This is what the site looks like. One of the requirements will be to plant one tree in the front yard. And then if you go to the next slide, we have begun doing an analysis of the number of short-term rentals within the vicinity. We're giving you the information as raw data, not telling you what it necessarily that it means that there are too many or too few or what have you, but thought you should have the data in order to inform any decisions you want to make. So within a 1 mile, there are 27 total single-family homes that have been permitted for short-term rentals. There are 21 total multifamily units for a total of 48. Again, that's within a mile. And the next slide, in 500 feet, there is just a total of two. And so it does not appear that the character of the community is being changed by the addition of this particular one. Next slide, please. Finally, next slide, the Planning Commission's recommend denial because of the complaint received from the neighbor or neighbors and the issues raised by the resident and were also submitted in a letter of opposition included parking on the street, more than two cars in the driveway, doors opening and closing at night, coming and going 6 to 12 people when there should have been only 10. I think the issue really was, the big issue was that the trash is allowed to sit out on the street for extended period of time, and then the trash cans, after emptied, continue to sit out on the street also for an extended period of time. The applicant responded that there will be cameras installed in front and back, noise monitoring of the property, and a very clear no party, no gathering rule, and he indicates that he lives less than 15 minutes away. Nevertheless, Planning Commission was concerned that he didn't have a clear program for eliminating the concerns expressed by the neighbor, and therefore voted 5-1 to recommend denial.
Okay, so this is very interesting. I knew this was coming up, so I've been having conversations with the East Ocean View Civic League president and then Scott Bateman, who's the new planning commissioner, who is very interested in this issue as well. I think he attended the meeting where this was discussed, but wasn't officially a planning commissioner. So here's the thing. There are so many illegal STRs being operated in the city of Norfolk that when we now have a process for people to apply for to become legal, that the argument that they were operating illegal at one point should be thrown out the window, because we're now asking people to comply and to become legal entities, which technically he doesn't have to, because we still have hundreds of these operating the city illegally with, as I wouldn't say no enforcement, but we don't have the staff to be able to enforce this the way that we could or we should. You know, you're working on that in the budget. So the East Ocean View Civic League is very torn about this. They have not met with the owner yet, and they're going to meet. They have a process that they set up. They don't actually go to their general membership anymore for a vote on short-term rentals, because it's so controversial that they've created a task force, a board that actually looks at each one of these applicants. And they have adopted, very similar to what I've been saying, this gold standard that they work with those that are applying to make sure that they implement the security cameras, that they put in the noise decibel readers, that they can respond within 15 minutes. And ultimately, they're going to come back and they're going to say that they support this and that they don't think it's fair that we're holding this guy accountable for a process that we've asked him to do. Keep in mind that this is a CUP process, that it's a two-year process, correct? They get 2 years on it. So we can pull it away. If this property becomes an issue, you can take it away from them. They just are worried that if we set a precedent that people go through this effort to become legal, that we just keep on denying it, that people will not go through it and they can't help control what happens. Although they do have concerns, as you saw by the map, that eventually there's going to be a saturation of these, and when is enough enough? And how do you say, you know, part of the issue is that there's not a quality hotel in Ocean View, and there's a desire for people to stay in Ocean View to enjoy the beach and enjoy the restaurants and the breweries and things, and they want to stay here. The businesses like this. A lot of our short-term rental companies are now working with businesses on putting coupons in there, you know, to go and visit them. So at some point, George, this conversation is going to continue, you know, with it. But, you know, I'm just letting you know the Civic League is going to meet with him next week. I think this comes to council on the 26th sometime on that. And they're going to ask us probably to support it after they've talked to them. The property owner that is opposed to it is a neighboring property owner, and her comment was she's just opposed to STRs altogether. I don't know. It's, you know, Courtney, I know you've had this controversy too over on your side. You know, I enjoy the maps. I hope that we can continue doing that and making those maps public for everybody to see that. Some of those are multifamily, so the appearance is that there's a lot more, you know, when they're multifamily. I'm also aware that the new code with sprinklers is going to change some of this as well, because as sprinklers are going to be required in the multi-units, that may reduce the need for this. But once again, and I had this conversation at the East Ocean View Civic League, you know, we've asked people to comply and go through this process. Should we actually be denying them for doing what they've been asked to do? Is a question. So, you know, I'd love to join other council members on trying to tackle this issue. I seem to have a really good share of these in the city. And the ones that are applying and complying are not causing problems in the community. The ones that are causing the problems are the illegal ones that we then may go through this process if we can. And we try to set this gold standard for them, you know, that they have to be good neighbors if they're going to do it.
In the for what it's worth category, staff recommended approval of this. We believe that the measures, the conditions that are proposed will in fact ameliorate the concerns that were expressed. So, and some of the items that were expressed we didn't really recognize as concerns in the first place. If I can go to the, okay, good. I just want to quickly remind you, you all have asked us to go out and look at all of the restaurants and entertainment and nightclub establishments in downtown. And so we've been doing a sweep of them. What we have found is that, and have issued a lot of notices of violation, what we have found is the prevalent violation is the establishments have not kept their list of managers up to date. So they will be coming to update their list of managers. And I wanted to remind you of something you did a year ago, which was make the process for updating managers a lot less expensive and a lot simpler and a lot faster. So it will not go to the, if it's just managers, it doesn't go to the Planning Commission, it comes straight to City Council. It's a $95 application fee, and it should be able to happen in about 3 to 4 weeks' time. Hopefully we can even shorten that process a little bit. Some of it is the time necessary to get it on y'all's agenda. But I just want to remind you that you created this process, and starting, I don't know whether it'll be next month or you know, late next month, you're going to start seeing these coming at you, and I wanted to make sure you were, you know, not caught saying what the heck is this, and give you a little bit of forewarning. That, Dr. Mayor, is all that I had, unless there are any additional questions.
All right, thank you.
All right, sir, that's all we got. We're ready for closed.
Cool.
With the members of the council, someone informed me closed meeting on April 12, 2022 at 5:59 PM in the 10th floor conference room of the City Hall building, the City Hall, for the purposes which are set out in clauses 1, 29, and 8 of subsection A of section 2.2-3711 of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act as amended.
Yep.
Clause 1.
And also on the motion, an additional legal item to discuss the council's new business portion.
That's in addition to the deserved.
Yes.
Okay. Clause 1 is discussion of the personnel matter. Clause 29, discussions of the award of public contracts in the military circle and downtown areas where discussion in open session would adversely affect the negotiating strategy of the public body. Clause 8, consultation with legal counsel regarding subpoenas for an April 25th hearing. Clause 8, consultation with legal counsel regarding disorderly behavior at meetings. And Clause 8, discussion with counsel pertaining to the business portion of the evening.
Thank you.
Ms. Doyle?
Aye.
Ms. Johnson?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Ms. Royster?
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. We're closed.